Thank you very much for the kind introduction. It's a great pleasure to see Urata-san, a good friend from a long time. And it's a real pleasure to be back at Rieti. I remember addressing your famous brown bag lunches many years ago when you were starting up. And it's good to see you still in such active mode. I also am glad to be speaking to, I'm sure, a lot of folks from METI. My very first extensive trip to Japan was sponsored by METI, your predecessor, back in 1976. I had come to Japan once before in 1966, a long time ago, but I had my first extensive trip in 1976 as a guest of METI. Spent 2 weeks in Japan and have been kind of a great friend and observer of Japan ever since that time. So it's a great pleasure to be back with you today and to talk about some really critical global economic issues. I start with three propositions about the future of the global economic order. The first is simply that an open and cooperative international economic order has been crucial to the prosperity and peace of the entire post-war period for the last 50 to 75 years. Japan, of course, has been perhaps the most brilliant example of the success of that system with its historic economic development and progress to where it's now a high-income country. China's growth may be somewhat parallel to Japan's, but of course, its average income is still a very small fraction of yours. And so I think it's fair to say that Japan remains the most dramatic development story in human history and is one of the great successes of the post-war economic order, which permitted and encouraged that to happen. The second premise is that the successful international economic order, not perfect, but very successful, has depended to an important extent on the global economic leadership of the United States, working, of course, with its key allies, including Japan. But U.S. leadership has been an essential ingredient, I think, of the success of the international economic order. The political scientists have something called hegemonic stability theory that says, in fact, you need one country to provide that kind of leadership if the system is to work effectively. I'm not sure that's right, but certainly the U.S. has done that effectively through most of the post-war period and been an essential ingredient in the success of the entire system. But the third premise is that the United States can no longer really play that role to the extent it has in the past, even with its good allies, including, of course, Japan. And the reason for that is, of course, the rise of China. The United States had been essentially unchallenged as the world's leading economy for about 100 years. And one reason the U.S. could provide global economic leadership is that it really had no challenger. It had no competition as the top economy. Japan, in fact, came the closest at the end of your period of dramatic growth. At one point, when the yen exchange rate got up to about 79 to the dollar, Japan's GDP got up to about 80% of that of the United States. So it was getting close. I remember Saburo Okita always used to worry that Japan was going to equal the U.S. in terms of GDP. He always feared that something would happen. I didn't agree with him, but he worried about that. But the point is that the U.S. Never had a real rival for top economy until now. And of course, China does now provide that competition, that challenge. China, on some metrics, is a bigger economy than the U.S. even now. It's a bigger trader. It's got far more foreign exchange. And so on many metrics, China is in fact already, you might say, the top economy, but in broad terms, and this is the conclusion of my recent book, China is roughly equivalent to the United States in terms of international economic power. What that means, of course, is that China's participation is essential to resolve most global economic issues, whether it's climate change, restoring an open trading system, dealing with financial and macroeconomic crises, dealing with pandemics. China's participation is essential. And it's therefore essential in turn to find ways to integrate China into the global economic leadership matrix so that it will carry out those responsibilities, cooperate with other countries, and work together to those ends. And of course, it's essential for the United States and its allies to find ways to integrate China into that cooperative leadership position in order to provide the foundation for the system to continue functioning in an effective way. I think China has shown its willingness and ability to exercise constructive global economic leadership on some occasions, like after the global financial crisis, 2008-2009, also on several occasions in the effort to address climate change, the Paris Conference 2015, the Glasgow meetings a couple of years ago. But China also, of course, undermines and subverts the global economic order with many of its own policies, both its trade and investment protectionism, its tendency to retaliate against others whose economic policies it does not like. The U.S., of course, does a lot of those things too, but China, I think, has a more systematic approach to do things like that, which undermine its capacity to exercise constructive global economic leadership, and of course, diverts from other countries' willingness to accept it into that role. So those, I think, are the huge challenges that we now face in trying to reorder the global economic system. The alternative, of course, is to continue what in fact has been happening for the last few years, namely the reliance on a number of middle powers to exercise the leadership that the U.S. can no longer do on its own, and sometimes subverts as well, or that China is yet willing or able to do. So it's a group of middle powers, notably including the European Union, but also in a very major way, Japan, which has provided the necessary leadership to fill the vacuum in this period when the U.S. was backing away from its leadership, particularly when President Trump simply abdicated U.S. leadership totally and backed away from most aspects of the global system that the U.S. had helped to create. And that, of course, led to a real systemic crisis, and other countries were required to fill the gap. Before I go further, I want to really praise Japan for the critical leadership role it has played during these last 5 years or so, along with the European Union and differently on different issues. But Japan, I think, must get major credit, perhaps the most credit of anybody, for keeping the open and cooperative global economic order afloat. And I know you all in METI and Rieti have had a big role in that, and I want to praise you for that. I think in particular, the way you kept the Trans-Pacific Partnership alive, converted it into the CPTPP when the U.S. left. You made a valiant effort to get the U.S. to come back in. When that failed, you did a kind of halfway free trade agreement with the U.S. That was also well done. Your agreement with the European Union, your agreement with your Asian partners in RCEP, your rapprochement with Korea. I think all those things were examples of real Japanese leadership in the global system. I'm old enough to go back to the period when Japan was just coming in to the global economic order in the late 1960s and early 1970s, Trilateral Commission and the original G7, G10, G5 at the time, with Japan along with the US and three Europeans, at a time when we were all calling for Japan to step up and play an international leadership role commensurate with its dramatically expanding economy. And as I look back now, 50 years, I would say Japan has done it. And I want to applaud that and take this opportunity to convey my praise for Japan for all that it has done. You've done it in the development finance field as well. I focus on the trade issues in this discussion today, but you've done it in a number of fields. And it's not only Japan, it's the European Union, some of the smaller countries, Canada and Australia. But the basic point is that in this uncertain period of US and Chinese conflict and confrontation and inability to work effectively together in most cases, it has been Japan, the European Union, other middle powers that have really kept the world economy afloat and have played a decisive role, in my view, in doing that, and I want to applaud it. Now, there's one other key variable that I want to describe before I start making suggestions for what we should all do next. And that's, we all focus on the rise of China, which of course is correct, as I say, and has to be figured out and how that can be integrated into the global system. But I also want to note what I'll call the rise of the United States. Because if you look back to the last 30 years since the end of the Cold War, the United States has grown faster by a much bigger amount, more successful technology expansion, most other variables than almost any of the other advanced or established or high income countries. Now, you in Japan know that very well, because from about that time, your growth slowed dramatically and has tended to plateau at low levels over that period. Not that that's necessarily bad, your demographics have been a big part of that. But the fact is that the US has advanced considerably faster and farther than any of the other industrial countries during this period. So there is no generalized US decline. The Chinese seem to believe that the US is in terminal decline and should be written off, but that just flies in the face of the facts, because the US has in fact done quite well for a mature, advanced industrial economy. Obviously, it has not grown as fast as China or India or Indonesia or a few other emerging markets, but it has actually expanded its lead consistently over the rest of the OECD countries, for example, during this period. One implication of that is that if you look at China and the United States together, that twosome, big two, you might call it, taken together, their lead over the rest of the world economy has increased dramatically. And that means it's all the more important for them to find ways to cooperate and exercise responsible leadership of the global economic order, because their own positions in it are getting more and more important, more and more central all the time. Yes, it's a multipolar world. There are lots of important economies, but the big two, as I'll call them for that purpose, have been expanding more rapidly than their counterparts. China more than the other developing countries, the US more than the other industrial countries, and therefore those two all the more important to get together and provide the needed systemic leadership. So that's the setting that I would lay out at the outset of my remarks. And it then does raise the question, what should Japan in the middle between the U.S. and China, what should Japan do now? I suggest there are really three basic objectives that Japan should be pursuing as it continues, I hope and expect, continues the leadership role it has assumed over this recent period. One, of course, is to push the United States to maintain or preferably increase its global economic leadership. U.S. leadership had been declining. I'd say in my book, I trace it back about 20 or 25 years. But of course, it really plummeted. It really plunged with Trump in the White House. The U.S. really did abdicate most of its global economic leadership and plunged to a new depth. That has to be reversed. Biden has been more civil, has done better in some respects, but has not really restored U.S. global economic leadership, certainly not in the trade area, but really not in other areas either. And so I think Japan and its colleagues need to push your friend, the United States, to get back on track. A big part of that, and that's the second point, is to urge the United States and China to get together cooperatively in managing the global economy. I'll suggest in a minute how that should be done. But what I'm really proposing is Gaiatsu for America. You and others, other friends of the United States around the world, need to help tilt the internal debate in the U.S., which I'll also talk about in a bit, but also help affect the internal debate in the U.S. in the direction of restoring, at least to some extent, the traditional U.S. global role. I'll suggest that's possible. And in fact, outside influence can be quite important. We've recently seen cases of that. And so I think Japan should definitely try to do that. But then the third thing for Japan, of course, is to maintain and even expand further, which I'll address a little bit in detail, its own leadership in global economic affairs that it has been conducting so effectively, so efficiently over these last 5 years or so, and I would hope and expect that it would continue. Now, I want to digress before going to my specific proposals for Japan's actions to address a question that I suspect many Japanese in your audience will ask, which is, can the United States be affected by encouragement or even pressure from Japan and other friendly allies in setting its own policy? Or is the U.S. irrevocably on the way to a Cold War with China? Lots of people think that. There are lots of people in the United States who would actually like to see that. And there are some in China who would like to see a new Cold War between the two economic superpowers. So it's a fair question of whether U.S. policy can be pushed, tilted, oriented in a more positive and constructive direction to head off the risk of inevitable conflict. The Thucydides trap, as it's often called, is that inevitable or can it be headed off with sensible policy choices? As you'll see, I am relatively optimistic that it can be headed off, and U.S. policy is already, I think, starting to change in a favorable direction, but I don't think it's by any means clear yet, and certainly it's not clear how the Chinese are going to respond. So I want to talk about both sides of that as I go ahead. But I do want to address for a few minutes the internal situation in the United States, because I know many of our friends around the world raise that question and have their doubts about whether the U.S. Can get back on track. It's true that there is a bipartisan political consensus in the United States about the seriousness of the China challenge. It's one of the few issues in the US now where there is pretty complete agreement across the aisle, in the Congress, in the public, in the polling of the public, that China is a real challenge and a real question mark for the United States. However, there is no consensus on how to respond to it. There is no consensus yet on a vision of the future of U.S.-China relations. There's no consensus on what the U.S. policy strategy should be. So there's agreement that there's a big problem, but not on how to deal with it. And that's where the opportunity lies to shape outcomes. Now, there have been some U.S. responses already to the China challenge, of course. A number of those have been domestic policy changes, which in fact are the most important. For the U.S. or any country to respond effectively to an external challenge like the China challenge, the key, of course, is what you do at home to improve your own economic performance, your own economic policy, pull up your own socks and improve your performance. And the U.S. certainly needs to do so in a number of areas. But last year, as I suspect you know, the Congress passed three major pieces of legislation. President Biden takes a lot of credit for them, and he certainly deserves a good deal of credit. There was a huge bill, the first in 30 or 40 years, to strengthen U.S. economic infrastructure, the so-called Infrastructure Investment Bill, which will make a dramatic change in the competitiveness of the U.S. economy. Second, was passed the semiconductor bill, but more importantly, it had in it a big increase in funding for U.S. research and development spending on new innovations, on new inventions, on strengthening the U.S. scientific and technological capacity. And then the third, the biggest of the bills, was the one toward the end of last year that was focused on energy investment, responding to climate change, promoting new investment in a whole range of energy supporting and climate improving investments in the United States. The three together account for almost $1 trillion of new U.S. investment in American competitiveness. It was driven not entirely by the China challenge, but that was a major factor in promoting the success of those new U.S. policies and winning bipartisan support for them in the U.S. Congress. Now, you know as well that there are some features of those pieces of legislation that I suspect you don't like. I don't like either. There's a lot more Buy American in there. There's a good bit of new industrial policy in there with subsidies, which kind of copy China in responding to it. I don't care for those features, but I do want to stress that on balance, I think it's been a constructive thing for the U.S. to respond in such a major way with new domestic measures to respond to the China challenge. However, nothing very clear has been organized with respect to China itself. We know that the U.S. and most of its allies, including Japan, will continue to have major problems with China on a number of security and political or values issues. There's no getting around the sharp differences on security topics, be it the South China Sea, the East China Sea, the Sea of Japan, Taiwan, a whole range of security issues where I think it's only realistic to accept that conflict and confrontation will continue. Likewise, on values issues, human rights issues, over Hong Kong, the Uyghurs, Taiwan again. So on those issues, I think we have to accept that there's going to be continued difference and probably conflict and even on occasion confrontation. But I would argue that at the same time, we continue those disagreements, we can, should, and indeed must find ways to cooperate on economic and global public goods issues, be it climate change, pandemic response, global trade and investment, responding to financial and macroeconomic crises. On all those things, as I said earlier, we must have constructive participation by China in order to resolve them effectively. To get that in turn, we need cooperation with China from the United States and its traditional allies in order to forge that kind of cooperative behavior in the interest of practicality and pragmatism in maintaining and indeed strengthening the global economic outlook. So what I propose is what I call functional decoupling. Decoupling between the security issues on the one hand and the economic issues on the other hand. Continuing to disagree on security, but working to agree and cooperate on economics. That is functional decoupling. It's very different from national decoupling. A lot of people talk about national decoupling between the US and China, just going their own different ways across the board on all issues. I think that would be a big mistake. I think that would be very costly for both. It would certainly be very costly for the world. And I think it would seriously risk increasing the possibility of conflict between the two superpowers and bringing on the Thucydides trap. So my proposal, functional decoupling, not national decoupling. Yeah, some de-risking is okay to try to make supply chains more resilient, less concentrated on one partner country, particularly when there is disagreement between them, but basically to avoid any tendency toward national decoupling in favor of functional decoupling. Now, the fact that I propose it is not all that important. What is important, and I want to stress this, is that I think the Biden administration is now headed in that direction. There have been two very important recent speeches by top officials in the Biden administration, as I'm sure you know, by National Security Advisor Jake Sullivan and by Treasury Secretary Janet Yellen, both of whom coincidentally traveled to China just within the last month and have been discussing exactly this approach with their Chinese counterparts. What both of them have said is very much in the direction of functional decoupling. Yellen said very explicitly, and Sullivan endorsed that, Yellen said, regardless of our disagreements on other issues, we must work closely together to resolve economic problems, global problems like climate change, in the interest of both our countries and the world as a whole. Sullivan and Yellen have been very clear that that approach is what they are now pursuing and seeking agreement from their Chinese counterparts in order to work out. Now, there is an important intellectual question as to how you distinguish between security issues and economic issues, because there are lots of products that are dual use, as we call them. The Chinese have this dual circulation concept where there's an overlap between civilian economic goods and military goods. And there are serious issues, intellectual as well as political, that have to be worked out in trying to make the distinction that I'm suggesting should lie at the heart of US and China relations. Sullivan, the National Security Advisor, has been very explicit in saying that what they want to do is, yes, control the export of highest technologies, as in semiconductors, to China, but to limit it to a very narrow part of the total economic spectrum. He talks about having a high fence around a small yard, and that's his effort to depict a situation where there are tight controls, but over limited areas of the economy. Now, the Chinese are suspicious of that. They think the whole thing is an effort to contain them, to suppress them, which would not work. It would be folly to try to do that. Trump tried and failed miserably. But the Chinese raised the question, and so it's a fair question to ask, how would one make the critical distinctions between security and economic issues in order to carry out a kind of functional decoupling? The Biden construct of China policy right from the start, as I mentioned earlier, has said there are some issues where we will have to confront them. There are some issues, a lot of issues, where we will compete, but there will be issues where we must cooperate. And what Yellen and Sullivan are both saying is they now want to get into high gear in pursuing that approach. My additional amendment is simply to say the cooperative basket should try to include virtually the entire range of economic relationships, because the two countries must necessarily carry out global economic leadership, even while they disagree on other topics. And therefore, I think we have a legitimate domestic debate within the United States, with the administration now coming out in favor of moving down this course. And I think at that point, encouragement and support from major U.S. allies would be very helpful. The Biden administration, as you well know, has stressed the need to strengthen the U.S. alliances. They've been doing it with NATO vis-a-vis Ukraine. They've been doing it with UN Japan and Australia, India, and the Quad and other efforts in Asia. They're very serious about that. They will continue it. But you may say, well, Biden may not get reelected. We might get back Trump. We might get some other Republican with Trumpism, even if it's not Trump himself. Those are all fair questions. And therefore, it is very important to try to lock in new, closer relationships and cooperative relationships of the type I'm stressing, while we still have time and support from people who want to do it. The Europeans have affected U.S. policy in a number of ways. The U.S. picked up the de-risking idea to substitute for decoupling from the Europeans. There have been trade agreements that they have reached with you in Japan and a bit with others. So my suggestion of Gaiatsu for America, I think, is something that you in Japan should and could and actually must follow up. So, final comment. What specific steps might Japan in the middle take to try to achieve these objectives that I have been outlining in the environment that I've described? I will focus on trade issues, since this is Rieti and Meti, but also because I think that's where Japan has done such good work and therefore has such credibility and therefore can quite feasibly carry out additional leadership steps. And I would focus here again on the CPTPP, the Comprehensive and Progressive Trade and Comprehensive and Progressive Trans-Pacific Partnership. I think that's the biggest issue, although perhaps the most controversial issue, that I would suggest that you pursue. My specific proposal is that you, as the de facto leader of CPTPP, go ahead as soon as possible to start the accession discussions with China. And the reason I say that is not only that I think it would be healthy for China to be in the agreement, which I think it would, but because I think if Chinese accession looked like being possible, that is the one thing that would galvanize the United States to come back in. You in Japan, Prime Minister Abe, tried very hard to get the U.S. to rejoin the TPP process, and Trump wouldn't have it. Democrats didn't step up either. But remember when the U.S. was in TPP originally, and President Obama was trying to sell it to the Congress, he did so on the grounds that it was absolutely essential for the United States to be in order to prevent China writing the rules for trade and investment in the Asia-Pacific region, which would be very unfavorable to the United States. So look what a reversal it would be if it looked like China was coming in to the CPTPP and the United States was outside. It would be a reversal of what Obama talked about, not just the loss of markets and the other things that the U.S. lost when it stupidly dropped out of the original TPP, but it would be a complete reversal. And you can imagine the political outcry in the United States, not just from business, which would be very disadvantaged, but from the whole political crowd, which would say, China is coming in, it's going to write the rules, we're going to be disadvantaged forever. And the way the United States would have to counter that would be to apply for accession itself. So it seems to me that that is the healthiest step that you and Japan and your Asian colleagues and the others in the CPTPP could take. And you might say it's a high-risk strategy. There's something to that. But remember, the alternative for Japan, the alternative for Japan is to be browbeaten, I use that term, to be importuned by the United States to block China. And that, I suspect, will be an immediate U.S. reaction. You may already have heard it from American colleagues as China applied to join the CPTPP. But if you accede to the U.S. wish to block China, then Japan looks like being the tool of the United States rather than responding to what I suspect the rest of the membership of the group wants to see, which is a comprehensive trade agreement among all the Asia-Pacific powers. Remember, that was the original idea in APEC, was to form a free trade area of the Asia-Pacific. And China itself pushed that at one point about 10 or 15 years ago. Now you and your colleagues have gone ahead with a partial free trade area of the Asia-Pacific, the 11 members of CPTPP, but the two big guys are still outside. And I think it would be hugely unbalanced for either of them to come in without the other. So it would be basically desirable to try to get them both to come in. I also think that if both China and the U.S. were negotiating with you and the other current members accession to the agreement, it might be a way, a better way for the U.S. and China to resolve some of their bilateral trade problem rather than trying to do so in the highly politicized spotlight of bilateral talks like Trump tried to carry out with them and which of course failed totally to get any changes in Chinese policy. But if China were seriously coming into your CPTPP trying to meet its relatively high standards and the U.S. was coming in at the same time, I think it would be a way for the two countries to deal with their problems in a very constructive way, a healthy engagement of both countries. If China and the U.S. were both looking for accession, I wouldn't be surprised if the European Union then said, hey, how about us too? And you would reinvent the WTO and have maybe a more effective multilateral trade agreement than we have in the world now. But that's farther down the road. At the moment, I would say, Japan, see if you can talk with China about accession, get them on a constructive path to accept the high standards of CPTPP, and watch the U.S. petition to join the parade in order not to be left behind. Now, there are things in other areas that could be done, but I've spoken long enough. I just want to wind up by saying all these proposals that I would make, like the one I just made with China, to come into the global leadership club have to be conditional. I mean, China obviously will have to accept and exercise in good faith responsibilities, as well as take on a bigger role, which they clearly want. It all has to be conditional. In my book, I call it conditional competitive cooperation. It's got to be conditional in terms of domestic politics in both the United States and in China. China wants to see the U.S. Stop violating as many of the international rules as it's been doing in its trade relations with China. So it's got to be conditional. But I think with that very important caveat, going down this path would be highly constructive. Again, I want to praise Japan for what it's done and urge it to do more of the same. Thank you for hosting me. I look forward to the discussion and to hearing comments and reactions from you and your audience.